What did you do with Marnie?
She's on the cutting room floor.
Welcome, ladies and gentlemen, to the cutting room floor. Joining us again today is the operator of ghostface.co.uk, Mr. Tim Wagstaff. Welcome back, sir.
Sir, yes, you got that correct. Yes, thank you. It's yes, sir, when you address me. Just say the name and that's all it is, Tim. Yeah, we're back again with Mr. Cloud. Dylan Cloud, cutting room floor. Yes, he got a few more views last time. I don't know why. It couldn't have been because of me.
No, you're really ugly. You draw people away.
You're drawing flies. Well, piss off.
But we have Mr. Timmy on the show today.
Don't do that one. Don't you dare do that one.
But he's here with us today because we're going to be doing a guide to the Scream movie masks. And today we're going to be starting with the original Scream 96. Since you are the call-in expert, shall we say, and you have many years of expertise and knowledge.
I wouldn't say expert. Let's just say I know a bit of this and that with regards to some of the molds. But again, as speculated before, none of us know everything. So we'll just say what we know and what we've noticed over the years with particular fantastics. And, you know, even mentioning the KMB that was used.
This is why I don't compliment you often, because you make it so fucking difficult.
Well, what do you want me to say?
I've never claimed
to be an expert. I've emphasized that on live streams. I've emphasized that on my website somewhere, I'm sure. But we just know bits and bobs about lots of different masks. And again, earlier masks are harder to define rather than the more recent masks, especially when you got RJ saying, oh, these were made this way or these were made that way, you know, like HHN or something. Whereas in the Fantastic Faces days, of course, RJ wasn't there and he didn't have any information from that time, basically 91, 92, 93. But yeah, there's little things that change over the years, obviously, and then we end up with what we do as time goes on, Gen 1s, Gen 2s, and obviously one of your favorites, EU stamps.
So in the area of masks, because a lot of people may not know this, is that the ghost face, or the weeping ghost as it was originally called, existed, mm-hmm. what, 5 years before the first Scream came out?
Yes. Yeah. Yeah. There's some people say 91, I don't know if it was out or if it was still in planning then. And there's others that will say, well, is there a 91 mask or was it 92 that it came? And I'm not sure which one it actually first arrived, whether it was Halloween 91 or Halloween 92. Can't be 100% sure, but yes. But before Scream, there was Weeping Ghost.
And as in today, still made by Funworld, and the original Ghostface mask would have came on a tag that says Fantastic Faces, which Tim has access to one that we can take a look at. And yes. Is that tag original?
This is an original tag, yeah. This isn't one of my replicas. This is basically one of the, I'm guessing this is one of the early-ish tags. Although recent copies have been on ebay.com and the font where it says superior quality, comfortable to wear, one size fits all. The font is a lot more basic and a lot more simpler on what I believe is early iterations of the tag. So I think this is sort of a later fantastic tag. Again, I can't confirm whether it's earlier, whether they change it to a simple font after, or whether it was vice versa. But this is basically, and what I own, the only tag Fantastic I have, and this is what we get on this particular tag.
And I'll throw a picture up on the screen right here to show a comparison between those two.
Yes.
So commonly, people in the hobby will refer to this as a Generation 1 Fantastic Faces.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. So, backstory into the movie, they were scouting locations and found in one of the locations a Weeping Ghost mask and said, no, we need to use this for the movie. Now, yeah. I don't quite remember, was it a white shroud or a black shroud that they found?
It was, in actual fact, according to Marianne, I think that's how I say the name, Marianne Madalena, that was Wes's producer and assistant. it was always believed that it was a black tag mask, and there was always this picture of a mask on a bedpost, which people said, oh, look, that's the mask that they found scouting, and it wasn't the actual mask, because that mask was a later version mask, and it was nothing like a Fantastic. But as you say, it was actually a White Shroud mask, and I'm guessing, again, it is a guess and a speculation, I wonder if the White Shroud mask on first impression may have made Wes thought that the whole costume should have been white, as they originally speculated, and then of course it got changed over time, as Nate Reagan can relate to as well. Nate can tell me a few stories about that particular instance, but a White Shroud Fantastic Faces is what was found on the location scouting, and Wes wasn't always so keen at first, apparently, but that's what they came across.
And when they went to Fun World to try to get licensing for the mask, there were some complications at first. For the first few weeks, they had K&B, who some of you may know, has worked on other horror movies, Halloween 5, you know, et cetera, had them kind of sculpt up their own version of the Generation 1 Fantastic, which you can see in the Principal Hembree scene, parts of the opening with Drew Barrymore, and a couple other places. Tim also has a replica of that.
Yes. I'm sure many people know the name of Clive Barzilia, a.k.a. Burt Bench Designs. I believe this is version two of Clive's recent attempts at making a K&B replica. Over the years, we all know there's been various K&Bs, and Clive's just seemed to be some of the more accurate. I haven't seen every K&B replica. I've not owned many personally. This was from Clive a couple of months ago. And this was based on Casey's scene. And Clive actually bases these off particular shots from particular scenes at particular times. But this is one of the most accurate, to my knowledge, K&B replicas out there without being a K&B replica, one of the real ones. But what they had to do at the time of filming was make something that was as close to Ghostface without being Ghostface. And even then, you know, the time was a problem, the shooting was a problem, and I don't know every single fact. Again, possibly Nate Reagan and others may know a lot more than me, but yeah, it wasn't the easiest thing to try and get out in a certain time, so this was a temporary measure with regards to what they were using. And they did have Fun World masks on set. One of them was quite regularly seen as a picture. There's like two masks together. And one of them says on the top of the forehead of a Generation 1, do not use on movie, around the top of the forehead. You're like, God, you've ruined that mask. But again, a deal was still trying to be ironed out and confirmed at that time. And it was always said in one of the documentaries, and maybe both the documentaries from 2011, that now and again, Wes would say, yeah, put that mask on, let's use it. Let's see, what are they going to do? You know, will we get sued? Something along those lines. Again, there's other people with different information that's possibly a bit more in-depth than what I can go into, because I don't know everything about all that.
But eventually they were able to use that mask, and for whatever reason, they weren't able to go and fully reshoot everything. So that's why you see, like, in the opening Casey scene, you know, within the same frame, the mask changes several times. And some people, you know, try to attribute that to one of them's Billy, one of them's Stu, but like it's changing in the same interaction with Ghostface. So it's just their inability to reshoot it. So it does take away a little bit from the movie. I think the K&B doesn't look all that great in the movie. But Clive does a very, as does Nag, does a very good replica of the mask.
Yeah, now, there's always different opinions. That's how it will always be.
And before anyone asks, this behind me is not a Generation 1 Fantastic. This is a Generation 2 Fantastic. I have this here for comparison because some people do think that these were used in the movies, and I do not. We'll get into that. But because these masks now are 30-plus years old, are increasingly rarer and rarer because, of course, they don't make them anymore. Their value is skyrocketing. So it's incredibly important to be able to identify them or know people who know how to identify them. So you don't get ripped off or buy a mask like this that's admittedly very similar. So what are some of the, as of right now, you know, pretty solid ways of identifying a Generation 1 Fantastic.
Well, you may well ask. You may well ask. One thing I've personally noticed over time, it's not just tick marks and indents in the mouth or dimples or whatever they want to call them. One thing I've started to notice a lot more is, and this isn't always a defining point of identifying, but for the most part on 99% of Gen 1s I've personally seen, there's a particular stitch line that goes down this side of the mask. And what it does, it appears to go more into the side of the mouth and into the mask itself rather than just being stitched to the side of it. It seems to protrude into the, you know, the side of the jaw rather than being symmetrical like a reshoot. Or even like the opposite side in many occasions. So this side here looks, you know, genuinely quite straight. Whereas this side, and I may have to get my other mask off to demonstrate better. Whereas this side, the shroud protrudes more into the jaw and then goes back out again as it goes towards the bottom of the chin. But of course, as many people already know, you've got the main dimple in the bottom. On some of them, you've got a dimple in the middle. On others, you've got the little mark in the center here, the little, almost like a splat into some say splotch. Some of them have a noticeable crease, which is very similar to the Generation 2 Fantastic or later Fearsomes, whatever you want to define them as. But yeah, me personally, it's hard to say now, knowing what we know compared to what we knew years ago when my mask page was last updated, and yes, it's soon to be updated even more, but it seemed to be, in recent months, these tick marks at the sides of the temples and the top of the forehead, can't always define, but it seems that on a lot of Generation 1s, if you peel back the streamers like this, and you look very close, which some fans I'm sure do, the tick marks or the little slits are more likely behind the streamers and you can see them. On the later masks, in some cases, probably not all cases, I'm trying to make sure I'm not completely wrong on this, but on some masks, in different cases, in later versions, the tick marks are actually sewn behind the shroud and you've got to look in the mask to find them. Although I'm sure it variates on many of these masks. So it's hard to say exactly whether it's an earlier or later Fantastic Generation 1, what can actually depict and fully confirm that it is a Gen 1, because of all these little daft differences in the molds, whether it's the splotch or the splat, whether it's a bit of a crease, whether it's a heavy crease, whether it's mainly you're always going to get a dimple in the bottom of the mouth, and the ones in the middle can again vary. Some are very faint, some are very prominent and appear to be very deep. Again, depending on when the mold was used and what year the mask originally came out, which is very hard to do with a Fantastic Faces. I don't believe anyone can ever say that's a 92 Fantastic, that's a 94 Fantastic, this is a first Fantastic, 91, 92, you know, whenever they came. But yeah, one of the protruding lines into the side of the jaw is what I've seen on many, 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 many Gen 1s, even if it's this type of what I believe is an earlier mold Fantastic, or even if it's the one in the distance here, this is possibly a later mold Fantastic, which is a lot thinner as well. So for me, hand cut eyes is always one of the biggest giveaways. Sometimes the paint job on the nose and even some of the markings in the nose can be a good giveaway, although the noses do differentiate among Generation 1s. Even so, some have got more of a straight line on the paint job at the bottom of the mouth, others have actually got the dip going up into the nose. It's really hard to say what's properly defines a Generation 1. Every single mask, whether it's a fan emailing the website or somebody on a social media asking, you've got to look at all pictures available and even take more pictures if possible to try and confirm whether it's a Gen 1 or Gen 2 or whatever else. Even some of these oddball types, there's, you know, Fantastic Faces tagged masks that have been known that look like a bloody tea stamp. Paint filled mouth, same cutout, you know. One was found recently. But for me, definitely lately, looking at many Generation 1 pictures and even my own masks, which are very few, sadly, with the early vintage ones, it does seem to be that the prominent merge into the jaw with the shroud seems to be on many, 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 many Gen 1s, whether it's the earlier or later molds, or, you know, particular marks on the mouth or the noses or the paint, etc. It always seems to protrude more into the mouth. Although, you know, who's to say that some Gen 2s aren't like that? Because as fans, we haven't seen every single mask, and you're probably never going to see every single mask. But yeah, it always seems to have a protruding jawline with most Generation 1s that I've personally seen. There may be different out there, I don't know. Ghostface can always surprise us. Look at the RDS lookalike that popped up recently that was a neon colour. Never seen him before. Never seen him.
Bring that Tag Gen 1 up in the center as much as you can, just so people can take a look at it. Bring it up just a touch more. Well, back up a little bit. There we go. And just so people can see, compared to this, because, you know, my Gen 2 has a little bit of a dimple in the chin, you can see how similar these are, and how, if you don't know what you're looking at compared to these two, I mean, it's very easy to get confused.
Yeah.
Especially when we found out recently the Gen 1s also, in some instances, have come on polyester shrouds and not just cotton shrouds. So that's not always the definitive way. And the reason we stress these things so much is because people will re-tag masks. People will put fake tags on masks. And since Gen 2s are so similar, you can't always just go on the tag.
Yeah. Yeah. A lot of people over time, including myself, admittedly, because you're still learning, you learn as you go along. Every single day you can learn something new about Ghostface, depending where you're looking and who's found what and who's posted what on social networks. But yeah, even in the past, myself and other fans, I'm sure, used to define masks solely by tags, which in some instances is fine, because if you got a genuine tag, fantastic, that's what it is. In other instances, when you've got a Fearsome Faces tag on the top of what is clearly a Gen 1, no matter what the shroud material, you know, again, that's where the comments start coming and the conversations start flowing. And you're like, oh, yeah, well, it's got this tag, but it isn't a Fearsome. And why is it not a Fearsome? Then you got to explain why, and you start going through the mold differences or whatever else it is that confirms that it's a Generation 1. But there's always a lot to talk about with identifiable features on the Gen 1 and Gen 2 masks. And it's, as you say, you cannot always identify simply by tag alone, because also for the other reason you did say again, someone could have re-tagged it, thinking it was the right thing to do and thinking they're either going to price gouge or whatever other reason they've done it for. But yeah, just remember, anyone with a tagging gun can put a tag on a mask. It's just if you're the recipient of that mask that may have been re-tagged, always check the top of the head, under the shroud, and see how many holes are in the mask. For the most part, there should be two holes only. Obviously, either side of the barbs where the tags originally attached. If there's more than two holes, that's when you've got your story that either one, was it a factory mess up, or two, as some bitch re-tagged it open to get a profit and you've just fell for his trick.
And what I say earlier about the Generation 2s, I used to be one of the people who thought that they were used in Scream, the original. Because, you know, looking at this, especially if I fan this out, you know, this could pass for, you know,
it could, yeah, it could.
For the ending of the movie when they're running outside the house, you know, et cetera. And the reason that I've come to think that certainly Gen 2s weren't used is because the Gen 2 was made by recasting the Gen 1 in an attempt to, you know, make fresh molds for the demand that was about to come from this movie. If the movie didn't start using the Gen 1s until 3 weeks in, and the movie would have wrapped a few months after that, Funworld would not have had enough time to make a new mold, start putting it out, and then enough time to send it to set for it to be on there. So that's why I think that any Fantastics on set for Scream 1 were Gen 1s and only Gen 1s. And if you wouldn't mind getting your other one to compare the two, you can see the differences that can exist between the same generation of masks just by how it came out of the factory, or it's been stored, or etc.
Yeah, let me just grab the other.
Bastard has so many good masks. gonna kill him one day.
Okay, let's get the sound back. Now, I pulled off three masks on this peg, not just the one, because I've got differences here as well. So, here we go. Now, this has been specified many times on my streams and even in information online. This is a replica tag, bendy, flexi photo paper, not real, many mistakes on purpose. If any some bitch coming here broke in, try to palm it off on eBay as a tag fantastic. Fans that know their shit will know it's not a tag fantastic. It is a fake replica tag with many mistakes on purpose. But this particular pink was my first ever fantastic, but this is the same
best pink I've ever seen.
Aye. Opinions. But this is the same mold, or appears to be the same mold, as the tag fantastic you saw previously, the white one. Indents in the bottom, indents in the middle. Noticeable crease, not as much as a Fearsome or a Generation 2, but definitely the same mold as what was previously seen minutes ago. And then we get to Mr. Green. I don't have an orange, sadly, but one day maybe. Now, this is a different one. This is a much thinner, much more flimsy mask compared to the two originally seen. So
beautiful.
This...
beautiful.
Yeah, this, I believe, maybe... a later fantastic. Again, we as fans can't confirm one way or another. It's assumption and speculation. And here,
just so everybody knows, fluorescent Gen 1s don't have eyeliner paint. No black eyeliner paint on a fluorescent.
And cut eyes.
On the Gen 1.
Mm-hmm. But this one doesn't show it as much because it's not as curved a mask as the one that I'm about to pull up. But on the next one that we're going to pull up, as you look down this side of the mask, you will see what I mean with the interfering shroud into the side of the mouth. See how it sort of comes and works its way into the jaw, then disappears again? And then this side, totally different. Totally different. So that this side is possibly, I don't know, how it should have been both sides, who knows? Or should it have been like this, both sides? But this always seems to be on many, many, many Gen 1s that I've seen over a long, long time. The protruding shroud into the side of the jaw that's even got a little bit of a curve on it. Whether it's just how the stitch, whether it's just how the mold was, whether it's just how they were cut before being shrouded, who knows? But you can easily see the differences in the mouth sides with how the shroud sits. And this, again, is like the green you've just seen. Thinner Gen 1, a lot more flimsy. You hold this, it's going to bend. Okay? You get to the pink, and he's bending, but he's not as much. So white is floppy. Of all the words. But white, very loose.
I bet you can relate.
Very limp. But this one, yeah, he's, yeah. This one, he's not interested in nice women, yeah? He's like, no. This one is like, well, yeah, I'm thinking about it. I haven't seen a face yet. Whereas a HHN is like, oh, yeah, she's nice for stiffness. But this one, again, not much bend. So pinky and white here, same identifying marks on the mold. And yes, Mr. Green and Mr. White in this case, same thing again. Same with the stitching, same with the shrouds. You know, same markings on the mouth, the mold, etc. Blah, blah, blah. Hand cut eyes. Although, let's have a look. We do have a difference here. So this green, as you may or may not be able to see, you should be able to see. No eyeliner, yeah? So this is a little splotch, little splat, bit of a fake, well, not fake, bit of a faint crease, but definitely prominent indent in the bottom of the mouth. Whereas on a mask here, in this particular instance with these masks, same in the mouth, little splatty splot, indent in the bottom, very faint crease, very, very faint crease, but we have eyeliner that appears to have been sprayed rather than brushed. So again, same as the green there, same mold, same markings, yet why the difference in eyeliner? And definitely seems to be, on looking close, hand-cut eyes. So again, differences with two of the same type of mold. So some may say this, oh, it's not actually a Gen 1 then, because you've got some sort of eyeliner. But, you know, it looks to have been sprayed on rather than hand-painted. It more so at the bottom of the eyes, but as you go around the rest of the eyes, it does look hand-painted. It's like got a spray effect at the bottom of the eyes, yet the rest of it is nice and neat in its lines. So a bit of a weird one in that respect.
So just so people can kind of have an idea, this is a Gen 2.
Yes.
People would look at this and say, there's a crease in the mouth.
Yeah.
There's a dimple at the bottom.
Mm-hmm.
How would they differentiate this as a Gen 2?
To differentiate by basically the crease being a bit more prominent and easily noticeable compared to the Gen 1s, although some Gen 1s do have prominent dents, creases, I should say. So you start thinking, well, what about after that? So looking at that one, you want to be looking either under the shroud or at the side of the jaw for the mold scars in some cases, not every single mass. So you've got mold scars on there. There they are. Yeah. Outside of the shroud, easily seeable. These were not present on the earlier masks. Although there were some scars on earlier masks, but there was always under the shroud for the most part. But yeah, there's your mold scars, which helps confirm it's a Generation 2 rather than an earlier mask. Although looking at that particular mask, there are some small similarities, as you said yourself, to a Gen 1. Particularly when he runs out of Stu's house at the end of screen one and just looks at him for a minute. That has a slightly similar look to what we're seeing there on that scene.
And actually, I think, and we'll discuss this in a future video, but I think this might have been one of those production runs for the Scream 2.
Oh, okay.
But we'll cover that at the next one.
That's the thinner one, is it?
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. But you can always see the Gen 2 has got quite a big eye. As you wear it, the right eye, as you look at it, the left eye. But that eye is massive compared to some Gen 1s that you'd see. Although some Gen 1s, again, they can have similar things. But yeah, you got quite a big eye on that one. And then the curved eye on the left, again, as you wear it, on the right, as you look at it. But yeah.
And just to finish this out, because price gouging has been ridiculous.
Yes.
What would you say is an acceptable range, price-wise, for a Gen 1? Because from where I sit, on the low end, untagged and in moderate condition, $500, to the other end of in great condition with a genuine tag, $1,000. And then in the middle, based on what you got. Just for comparison, 2 years ago, I sold a full set of Gen 1s for $1,250 of all three fluorescents. Right. And now you see them go on eBay for that much individually. Now, I don't think they're selling for that much, but people are trying to ask it. And someone might pay for it. So what would you say is a good range?
It's hard to define sometimes. So let's go to one of these without a tag, yeah? So green, early-ish generation one. Decent condition, no mouth cuts, no holes in the nose, you know, just a mask that's surviving for whatever reason, probably not a lot of smell left on it, but I don't want to get into particular identifiable bloody things like that, because you're not going to know that when you're looking on eBay. You're just going to see images of a mask, and you're not going to know whether this smell or whatever. All you want to know is the mask is intact and the shroud's attached and not the worst condition. Personally, with this one, this was a trade, and a very good trade. But price-wise, so say early-ish green generation one, no tag, no sufficient damage, so to speak, weather mask or shroud, eye mesh, etc., paint. I always like to think between $450 and $550. That's dollars, okay? That's just my opinion. I'm sure there's going to be people commenting, well, I don't think that's fine. That's my opinion. Again, bear in mind that's the thinner, more easy to maneuver, fantastic, shall we say, yeah. Thinner, flexible. if you come across eBay and you've got one of these, no matter what the colour, this, what I think may be the earlier mould with the two dents in the mouth and, you know, again, hand-cut eyes, no eyeliner, decent condition, decent shroud, blah, blah, blah. Again, I'd say no tag. I'd honestly think a similar price, whether it's a thinner Fantastic or this somewhat earlier, thicker version. I think same price as said before, because there's no tag, but they still are what they are. So they've, you know, they've got an half decent price. And again, that's for greens, that's for oranges, that's for pinks. It doesn't matter what colour. That's for white. If they're all tagged. Whereas if you come across one of these, again, whether the thinner version, whether the thicker one, depending on mould, whether it's a little splat in the middle, whether it's the prominent dents in the mouth, the dimples. If you come across these with a tag on, and again, difference in the fonts at the top of the tag. Dylan is probably going to have to put an image onto this video so people can understand what we're talking about, but there is a difference in fonts on the tags. There's a really plain, bold and simple font, which I believe to be an earlier version. And there's this one that's more commonly seen, which is a more of an italic and sort of posher font. But yeah, there seems to be these sort of two types of tags out there. But price wise on these, I mean, personally, this was $1,000 to me a few years ago via Douglas Little. And I should always be grateful for letting me purchase it off him in installments. So $1,000 then, and as many people have heard before, I told RJ what I'd paid, and I said, RJ, $1,000, tag Fantastic. You guys are crazy. That's what the exact words on the phone. You guys are crazy. I think I even got it on an email as well. $1,000? I was like, yeah. Why? I says, well, tag Fantastic, genuine. That's his words, man of ghost face, yeah? All right, it wasn't there from the creation, but it was there from before Scream was started. And he just said, you're crazy. It's a Halloween mask. I said, yeah, but it's now a vintage Halloween mask. Remember how old it is. Remember its original tag, you know. In this particular case, yeah, it's been signed. But
who signed it?
RJ, Alan and Stanley Geller. And sadly, as some may know, in August of 2020, sadly, we lost Stanley Geller. So as shitty as it is to say, the price probably raised a little bit with that very nasty tragedy, because honestly, he should still be here. And yeah, he was quite a character as well, as I understand. And I used to send RJ flaky bars, as they call them, as he calls them, Cadbury flakes. And he'd come into his office now and again, you got any candy? You got any candy? He'd be asking him for his candy. You got any candy? Has he sent you any more candy? And yeah, he had a few good stories, but yeah, Stanley signed it, Alan signed it, and RJ signed this particular one. There's a Drupal Fearsome on a road just here that, again, the same three people have signed, but it's a fake replica tag by Ryan Hills. But even then, it's, you know, I like it on the tag. But value-wise now, 2021, I mean, $1,000 off Douglas, no signatures, yeah? I got it signed. I see these for $1,000 now, and even though I paid $1,000 without it being scribbled on, of course, I still thought, God, that's pricey for a mask. And even RJ, you know, you guys are crazy. I think Tag Fantastic now should be $1,000 and probably stay at $1,000, but that's just my opinion. $1,000 is still a stretch for a Tag Fantastic. It's an old Halloween mask. Some of them, sadly, like this is a victim too. The shrouds are that old that they start to crumble. I don't like taking it out of the frame all the time, because after a while you look at the mask and there's these little black dots all over it. You think, what's this? We've not really done anything with the mask. We've not wore it. We've not killed anyone. But it's just the shroud, due to whatever it was stored like in the past, literally crumbles. Whereas this chap here, the thinner one, you know, replica tag, It's like it's just come out of the factory. It's flexible. There's nothing coming off it. It's not decaying. So I'd say, yeah, decent condition, Tag Fantastic. These days, my opinion is $1,000 should be enough. If people are charging more, then If you know him, try and work out a trade and give him a couple other masks. If you don't know him and you're going to bid it, then basically it's going to end on whatever the bids go for, depending who wants it, how bad they want it. But I'd honestly say, personally, I'd like to say 900, 1,000 should be the sort of range that a Tag Fantastic genuine should go for. And there's always little bits to look out for to see if it's genuine tagged. And there's always sometimes telltale signs as to whether it's been retagged. And on odd occasion, for whatever reason, with factories or F-ups or mishaps, there are tagged versions of these out there that are real that don't have 9206 as the item number. I know one chap in particular, his says 9205. Some Fun World X employees confirm there was the odd mishap and there was the odd, you know, mistake where the wrong tag would go on a fantastic mask from that line, and it would say 9205 rather than 9206. Just that one little fact could make any collector weary and think, is this a retag? Not always the case, and I do know of one in existence with an Irish collector, and it's not a retag. We did think it was a retag, but it wasn't. And he almost let that thing go because he didn't know what it was for £200. English pound, 200. Yeah? He almost let it go. And then I messaged him, said, oh, yeah, excuse us, mate. What's this mask here? Is it a retag? What's going on? And we all looked at it, had a good gander at the pictures. He took many pictures. And it honestly looks like a factory mishap because it's too good to be fake. So, again, 900, 1,000 is my sort of preference on them.
And just keep in mind, everybody, cotton T-shirt material and vinyl weren't made to last forever. So there's any investment you make. You know, store it well, store it in proper temperature, out of sunlight, and do the best you can to preserve it as best you can, because it may just fall apart on you one day.
Yeah. I mean, this one, it's always in its frame at the back here, and it's in all honesty, it's not displayed how it should be. But this particular house, this particular room is what they call south facing. So early in the morning, if the sun's out, this room's taking the sun. And if this was displayed on the back wall behind me, this would be slowly deteriorating even faster than normal, especially with regards to the shroud, because the sun would just kill it. But it sits in a frame and it's out of the way, and it's, you know, it's sad really, because I have to do this with Collector's Edition Deluxe Mash. You got to keep them separate for different reasons, but you'd never see them, you know. And they say, oh, look at all these masks, they're hanging up loads of different types, but where's this type, where's that type? I'm like, well, you know, we can't display them. One, because of the sun, and two, because of other problems, you know, with the Deluxe as we know. But yeah, this thing, it doesn't get the time out in the open, so to speak, as it deserves. But sadly, it has got a bit of a mix and match shroud on it. One side's not too bad, and the other side's almost going stiff now, and it's crumbling. But it's just showing its age. But 900, 1,000 is sort of ballpark, in my opinion.
So that's kind of where we are right now with the Scream 1 guide. Of course, we will do 2, 3, 4, and 5 when it comes out in the future. Mm-hmm. I want to thank Mr. Tim for coming back on again with us and helping in some of the areas where I'm not as knowledgeable, and especially with some of the masks that I don't have. They are always lovely to see. Yeah. And until next time, everyone, I've been Dylan Cloud, and we're going to leave it here on the cutting room floor. Thanks for watching.